Gandhi, I'm from SAP. I'm based out of US in Philadelphia, and I globally lead our IoT innovations and the go-to-market, and primarily focused in a lot of industry verticals, especially on the transportation side, logistics, and also consumer industries in general, which includes life science, CPG, retail, and so on and so forth. And then my major focus is to kind of, you know, drive the adoption of IoT within these companies. As I get started, let me just fire up a video to set the stage here.
Using technology is a critical differentiator, changing the expectation that the consumer will have for what a sports brand should be for them. This is where we're going to need a big, bad technology partner. Bring in, cue the bell, SAP. Under Armour is a live business. We can anticipate the issues and needs that you're going to have using live data to really understand the needs of the athlete, to make better decisions that meet our consumer where they are. The right place with the right product at the right time. The days of the 18-month supply chain are something that we are quickly putting in our rearview mirror, with plans in place right now to cut that by as much as 20 to 30 to 40%. So what SAP really does for the Under Armour brand, it truly allows me to run our business end to end.
I usually like to kind of, you know, run this video ahead of time and kind of talk about what Under Armour has done with their overall supply chain, as well as how they have transformed the business.
The design thinking journey at SAP began in 2004. Hasso Plattner, one of the original founders of SAP, was captivated by an article about design thinking. He felt in his heart that his...
Just flipped over to another video, my bad. So, coming back to this particular video, I mean, if you look at what the CEO was talking about, how they have transformed their overall business from just being a sportswear provider to now connecting the hundreds of millions of consumers and gathering their data and acting on their insights and telling the customers how they can, you know, live their life healthy. At the same time, they are selling their goods to those customers based on what they see. What is the lifestyle of this particular consumer, right? So it's about direct engagement with the consumer. It's about bringing that IoT data and then making use of it. So in general, if you look at most of the companies, I mean, you know, we talk about the hyper-connectivity, we talk about, you know, digitalization of the world. There are two key things in my mind what most of the companies are doing. One is leveraging IoT for digitally transforming their business, how they operate their business end-to-end, right? We talk about manufacturing, we talk about warehouse transportation management side of the world, but then taking it outside of the four walls and connecting the logistics and getting the end-to-end visibility. So that I call it as transforming their business in terms of digital transformation. The second aspect is about how they can drive the newer outcome and then get into the Uberization of the enterprise. What I mean is that how you can run your business digitally, right, without having to invest heavily into the capital infrastructure and so on. But these are two key things when I talk about outcome-based economy and participating in outcome-based economy, leveraging IoT, right? And I'll show you the example of how SAP customers are kind of benefiting in this digital transformation across the board. Coming back into some of the key challenges that most of our customers are facing today, right, when they talk about their logistics business, and especially the supply chain, if you look at the logistics part of it, the majority of the cost goes into the transportation side of the world, right? And also, from the perspective of how you can engage with your customer, give them their information right on time as to when their goods are coming and so on and so forth, today they lack the transparency when the good leaves the factory. They do not have, so to say, in their ecosystem, the connectivity with their logistics service providers, right? So how we can make this end-to-end supply chain more connected is the key aspect of it. And that's what we are looking at, a key transformational element for most of the business if they want to kind of, you know, look at bringing the operational efficiency, reducing the cost, at the same time driving some of the aspect in terms of better customer service and so on and so forth. What this leads us into are the three key strategic priorities what most of the CEOs are looking for today. Right? One is about operational excellence that would help drive the bottom line, so to say, in terms of reduction of the cost and bring better operational efficiency within that business. The second part is also about the customer service and the delivery aspect of it. You know, if you have a most efficient logistics where you can provide the visibility of your products as they're flowing from your warehouse to the distribution center, to the retailer, to the end consumer, and get that view in a centralized operation center as a command and control, and then they can kind of regulate based on the traffic pattern, based on the congestion and so on and so forth. Talk to the truck driver in the last part and say like how they can navigate to kind of reduce their transportation time. That is what the power of IoT brings in. One last thing that we should not forget is about sustainability. I mean, everybody talks about sustainability as if it's some of our corporate responsibility. But customers that we have worked with, they have seen that this, if they work on sustainability aspect of it with IoT, they can also reduce their cost. A few of the examples I'll give for some of the logistics service providers, they monitor as they collect the vehicle data and so on and so forth. They monitor how much idling time each of the truck has at the warehouse of their customers, right? And based on that, they are now charging the demurrage to their end customer as well, saying that, hey, if I'm delivering this goods, let's say 10 o'clock and I'm waiting for 2 more hours out there and my driver is kind of, because it's a refrigerated truck, he has to keep the truck running, I'm going to charge you demurrage. On the other hand, if the driver is just switching on the AC and sitting out there, they would immediately know and they can call out that driver behavior and reduce that sort of the carbon impact. And while doing so, can reduce the cost of operations as well. So these are the three key aspects, how you can kind of reduce your cost and also drive a better engagement with the customer to drive the top line revenue, right? So this is what, when we talk about IoT, we have to look at the aspect of outcomes. That's the primary aspect to focus on when you embark on any of the projects, right? So the two key elements and how I've segregated these outcomes are, one is the aspect of cost reduction in terms of better efficiency, reduction of the cost, the carbon impact, and so on and so forth. And out here, it's about how you can run your business digitally and then come up with a newer business model like usage-based pricing and so on and so forth. Now, customers that we have worked with across the board in terms of, from the manufacturers and so on, I'll give you an example of Kaiser Compressor. They manufacture the compressors, right? And they sell compressor as a capital investment for the end customers. But compressor is now a commodity for them. I mean, if you look at, there are a lot of manufacturers out there and to sell such a high-end compressor at a higher price requires something unique to be done. So the model that they came up with is that they wired up their compressors, they implemented our IoT solution around it. And two things they're doing. One is the predictive maintenance for the end customers in terms of, giving them the proactive service. And second thing that they've started is a newer business model around selling air as a service versus selling the whole capital equipment. So this is the power of IoT, how you can change your business by collecting the data, evolving your business, and driving the newer outcome. And SAP is in a unique position because we can provide that end-to-end solution. We just don't stop at collecting things data or giving you only the insights, which is what most of them talk about. Okay, I get the insights, but what's next after the insight, right? I want to drive some new outcomes. That is what we are focused on heavily in terms of enabling the customers in this overall life cycle of things to outcome. So before I get into more details, I just wanted to give you a quick overview of three key elements of our strategy. One is our platform. Like anybody else, we require a very, very strong platform capabilities from the IoT perspective, which handles data ingestion, the intelligence, the security aspect of it, ability to capture the big data, right? And also the aspect of driving high speed analytics, and then converting, taking this data from the OT perspective, I would call that as an operational technology, combining your ERP data models into this and driving certain newer outcomes so that you can run some industry specific, some industry-specific vertical solutions like connected manufacturing, logistics, and so on and so forth, which are industry-specific solutions that we can offer. Let me give an example of a customer, a very unique customer from the logistics side of the world, Hamburg Port Authority. The key challenge that they have is that their port is right in the center of the city. And the amount of goods and the containers that they're handling, the demand is increased day by day, but they cannot increase their facilities and infrastructure because of the space crunch and so on and so forth. So what they did is that they implemented this IoT solution, and I'll kind of tell you a little bit more detail around it, how they went about it. The key aspect that they achieved, just to keep in mind, is that they doubled the cargo handling facility without any capital investment, right? At least that's the target. And also from the perspective of sustainability, from the aspect of how they manage the trucks flow from their port, they control that and bring in right at the time, coordinated when the ship arrives, and it's just in time in terms of loading, unloading, and moving it out versus trucks sitting and idling in their premise. And also in the city, from where they flow, right? And they can manage the trucks flow in the sense they can park it 10 miles in the geofence outside the city, and they would call in when, as and when needed, right? So let me run this video for you so that you can get a better sense of how they have done this.
The whole world is becoming responsive. Intelligent sensors can anticipate our needs. The Internet of Things is a game changer for the Port of Hamburg, with a goods turnover of 140 million tons each year. Numbers are expected to double by 2030, a serious challenge for the Hamburg Port Authority. Located right in the heart of the city, with limited space for expansion. To grow, the turnover of containers needs to be faster. The port has to ensure that trucks, ships, and containers are only in the harbor area when they are really needed. The Internet of Things brings the solution. Every component in the harbor is communicating with each other. Ships, trucks, people, cranes, bridges, and traffic control systems. Everything is providing data to give insight to the business. Trucks reach their destinations faster. Drivers know where to unload more quickly. Shippers can plan their tours proficiently and react to new challenges in real time. As a result, the port can handle more goods faster, simpler, and impact businesses way beyond harbor premises.
So this was a good use case around logistics, which is kind of widely recognized as one of the most innovative use cases that we have implemented with the port. But we are also working with the big manufacturers who has the big warehouse both for the incoming goods and the outgoing goods. And the benefits that we have seen, especially working with the biggest chemical manufacturer in the world, I can't name it right now. For them, they bring in a lot of hazardous goods for the manufacturing, which they cannot store in their facility. And they have to schedule the manufacturing based on the goods when they come in. So they have to monitor exactly when those goods are going to come, if they get stuck in the traffic and so on, how can they, you know, kind of avoid the loss of that manufacturing time. And that's a huge, every hour that they lose for the goods not being available, that's like hundreds of thousands of dollars of, you know, cost that they incur. And then they are leveraging a similar solution for their own warehouse as a port, where they monitor and coordinate when their goods come in and goods go out and when the trucks come in and so on and so forth. And at the same time, they have the full visibility from the point of origin of that goods, and then can visibly see and proactively kind of, you know, system alerts them if there's a delay, and they can take a proactive measures ahead of time to kind of mitigate those. So let me now move on to the transportation side. Now, this is another very, very unique use case. Some of you may have heard. A few weeks ago, we had a big event in Rome as well, where we made some of the biggest announcements, where SAP put their commitment also in terms of investment of about $2 billion for the IoT business. Our CEO made that announcement there. And we did that in a Trenitalia train, which is fully connected. And what we do there is the predictive maintenance, memory of that particular moving assets. So it's a high-speed trains where we are going and kind of, you know, taking the data out of the train and then proactively for each and every principal component, could be brakes, could be pantograph, could be doors. We are advising, system advises the maintenance group as to when to maintain and avoid over maintenance and the under maintenance that enables, so to say, better uptime of the trains as well as reduction of the cost of their maintenance. So one of the paradigm I would kind of put out there from the key takeaways that, you know, typically you, if you look at the maintenance of such a moving assets like aircrafts or trains or what have you, the paradigm is that if you don't do your planned maintenance, your risk goes up, right? But here we kind of disprove that paradigm, saying that if you do the maintenance right on time, you can reduce the cost, but at the same time, you can increase the uptime by predicting the failure. And by doing the conditioning monitoring, you can kind of proactively ascertain when that train is going to fail, and you can proactively go and do that maintenance ahead of time, right? So that you can make sure that it doesn't fail while in operation. And so the great use case, and then the benefits that they are seeing in terms of ROI, it's in matter of days and months, I would say, right? So they are looking at 8 to 10% reduction in maintenance cost. And for such provider, we are talking about a base of 1.3 odd billion euro maintenance annually. And that's the kind of reduction they are seeing on top of that base. So let's look at it live, what they have done.
Trenitalia is the leading Italian rail transport operator, wholly owned by the Gruppo Ferrovie dello Stato Italiano SPA. We carry about 2 million passengers every day, with volumes of up to 250 million train kilometers on an annual basis. We are organized into different business units, which cover long-distance passenger transport, commuter traffic, and freight services on both a national and international basis.
Our goal is to carry out conditional maintenance rather than, as has previously been the case, according to a fixed schedule based on time or number of kilometers.
The new dynamic maintenance management system is a project developed in partnership with SAP, which exploits the full potential of the SAP HANA platform. One aspect that puts us ahead of the competition in the transportation market is the large amounts of data managed on an annual basis, which will exceed 700 terabytes. The ETR 1000 is a technologically advanced train which is designed to reach a speed of up to 360 kilometers per hour. In a high-speed system, everything, the entire system, must run at the same speed. So it's vital that maintenance facilities can react rapidly to operational stresses as well.
For the railway sector, the most innovative aspect of the Internet of Things is the large number of sensors that are on board the trains. The sensors record many different parameters, like temperatures, pressures, and so on. The data is processed by SAP HANA, and the system then provides the rules to define the required maintenance actions.
To be able to anticipate events and maintenance operations will enable our company to reduce errors and make processes more efficient, and also deliver better services with continuously improving quality standards.
We expect a reduction of maintenance costs of 8 to 10%, which, for our company, is a very significant value, because every year, we spend around 1.3 billion euro on maintenance. It will also improve the reliability of trains, and with that, we have less failures and a better availability. Therefore, we will have more trains available to provide more services. In that way, we can provide a better service to our customers.
SAP helps Trenitalia run simple.
As you see here, I mean, this has really set the stage for the transportation industry, especially the moving asset side of the world. And we are working with, I would say, most of the railways right now, kind of trying to replicate this model across different areas as well. Now, I looked at it from the moving asset side. Of course, we have lot of logistics service providers who are working with us across the globe as well. Customers like ARI, who provides the fleets and so on. So those are like, you know, trucks and cars and so on. They kind of lease the fleet. And what they are doing is that they're collecting this data on our platform and then providing the insights to their end customers on driver behavior and also the insurance companies, where they can kind of, you know, look at the risk profile of a driver, and based on that they can make a quote as well. So those are kind of use cases that we are seeing as well, which is kind of beyond the transportation where our customers are doing. And one of the partnerships that we had announced earlier this year at NWC, some of you might have seen that, was with SEAT, which is a Volkswagen here in Spain, and Samsung, in terms of how we are collecting this fleet data and also providing a connected vehicle solution to them. This is just some of the examples of the customer. So coming back at the overall stack, right? So as you would see, I mean, we are not just stopping at the platform. Of course, we are creating our IoT platform on top of our HANA platform and enhancing the services. I'll kind of get into more detail around that. We are providing a lot of cross-industry solutions across the base. And one of the unique things that we are putting is this whole command and control, what we are calling the digital operations center. I'll come into that as well in a second as well, and then talk to you about what that is, right? And this is one of the key things that most of the customers are looking at. I mean, yes, you can collect the insights, right? What if you can have a command and control center? Let's say you're doing a manufacturing or the logistics, the operations. You can have that command and control center, big screen across your board. It would tell you exactly what's happening at any given time, but also in a predictive mode, you can write some kind of a machine learning logic behind the scene, which would tell you, like, you know, okay, based on this weather pattern, I'm combining the weather pattern with the incoming data and telling you what would happen next, right? And you can take the actions. So that could become like a command and control room operations, but you can also, based on the personas, you can create small command and control by the persona as well. So this framework allows you to kind of visualize your data, is one thing, but you can act on that data and operate on that data by sending commands or doing certain tasks, maybe communicating to your backend ERP in terms of, I want to create a service ticket, I want to, you know, create a work order, for example, or create an order, a sales order based on something that's happening, right? So it can also talk to your IT systems seamlessly, right? That's a very unique aspect of it, and then we can cover the whole end-to-end businesses from a traditional business to kind of, you know, taking it from the logistics side, which are outside of that. So let me give you an example of what we do from the transportation logistics perspective for our traditional companies as well. Of course, we have the connected manufacturing, which sits behind. If you take the thing out, we have the connected warehouse management to automate your warehouse with robotics and so on and so forth. Aspect of connected transportation management, which are like more like an ERP-like products, right? So this is within the four walls of your organization. But then taking it out of your four walls and providing this end-to-end connectivity with the aspect of, you know, track and trace. So let's say if you're a life science customer, you are delivering the vaccines in a cold chain, in a temperature control manner. You want to track that temperature throughout the life cycle of that particular delivery, right? Which becomes like a proof for your doctor saying that I kept this vaccine always under 30 degrees centigrade, let's say, right, so that you can use it. That becomes kind of a proof for you as well, kind of to it. But you can do track and trace for a lot of different purposes as well. And then creating that full logistics hub, which is what we saw for the Port of Hamburg, and you can do it as your manufacturing facility, and bring the ecosystem of your logistics provider within your transparent view so that you can communicate with them in real time. You can control when the truck is coming, going out. You can talk to the driver one-on-one. You can send in which route to take at any point of time based on where he or she is, right? And of course, from the connected vehicle perspective, once you collect the vehicle insights, what do you want to do? Are you an insurer? Do you want to kind of, you know, provide an outcome-based insurance instead of giving the fixed plan, 6-monthly insurance, right? So a lot of these insurance companies are also now looking at, if I'm living in a city, I want to buy 1 week of insurance because I want to travel somewhere, right? Based on the driver profile, they can give that 1 week of insurance to that particular person. Today, they cannot. So they are also getting into that connected vehicle, and we are working with a lot of the insurance companies to be able to do that as well. And of course, we saw the Credit Alia use case with the asset management aspect of it as to how you can do this conditioning monitoring and the predictive maintenance and so on and so forth. So that, in the end, becomes what we have seen here is these are the real life example of the business benefit that our customers are kind of getting, right? In terms of increasing the supply chain margin, how they can increase the shipment capacity, leveraging IoT without doing any capital investment, right? And then the reduction of the cost and so on. I was talking about this command and control center. This is one of the examples that we have implemented at our customer as well. This is for one of the biggest city in China. As you see here, they can look at the traffic pattern in real time. So what's happening there, they can kind of drill down by the area and location, zip codes, and kind of filter it down. Of course, they can look at the video feeds as well. On the right-hand side, as you see here, we are combining the weather data with the traffic pattern and kind of doing a prognosis. If it's going to rain, let's say at 4 o'clock today, right, and it's a peak hour normally, how would that traffic behave? And based on that, they can open up a lane or two so that they can remove the decongestion by being more proactive, right? So this command and control center helps them do that. And of course, based on each person, what task they are doing, they can have their own little command and control center on top of this data. So the possibilities are immense. We provide the framework for you to be able to do that. Let's quickly talk about the platform also. And I'll give you a quick refresher in case you have heard about it. I mean, this is a pure play cloud platform, enabling the big data capability, providing the end-to-end capability in terms of how you can, you know, create analytics, create mobile front ends securely, and so on and so forth. So all those things are built into the platform. I'll cover that a little bit later. What we have added is the IoT point of view inside the platform, right? So some of the key takeaways here are smart data streaming. So what that does, right? It enables you for the high velocity messaging in a low latency condition to be able to kind of stream the data, number one, and ingest the data inside the platform. And also you can do the data tiering based on your strategy of hot data, cold data, and so on and so forth, and decide where it would reside. Now, of course, our HANA platform is an in-memory platform that enables that speed for the hot data. In case you want to run the analytics, it's the fastest, so to say, database out there, in-memory database out there. But at the same time, all the cold data, you can tier and automatically determine where you want to store in some kind of a cold, cheap storage like Hadoop or what have you. And you can redirect the data and run the analytics on top of it at a later date, or you can do a predictive kind of analysis and machine learning on top of historical data. You could do that, right? And of course, the whole angle of security is kind of built into that as well. On the edge, like anybody else, edge is a necessary evil. So we provide a very powerful edge capabilities with about 60 different protocol compliance, right? I mean, we practically cover each and every protocol that are out there. Modbus, Profibus, the old protocols, the new protocols, Zigbee's and Raspberry Pis or what have you. So we have made a big effort in terms of the protocol compliance. The other aspect is it's intelligent in terms of you can set the rules, you can run the analytics right at the edge, right? And it can also take care of the low latency scenario. What I mean by that is that if you look at Credit Alia use case, they do not transmit that data from the train synchronously to the platform, right? They also have an operator at the edge inside the train who can visualize the analytics and so on. But at the same time, there's no connectivity when the train is riding. They do not use the internet when the train is riding. They come to the station and then they send the data in batches out there. So we do an offline sync as well. We call it the remote data sync. So you can do, of course, do a real-time streaming, but also you can do an offline streaming. That's very unique to SAP around that. And as we are streaming the data in here, I mentioned about smart data streaming with the high velocity ingestion. Just to give you an example, this is the same event server processing that we acquired with Sybase, which are being used in the financial institutions, like, you know, Visa and so on and so forth, where you're running millions of transactions at the same time. The same technology has been kind of brought into this for the smart data streaming. That way we can have millions of devices sending the data at the same time. Even if it's a low latency scenario, we can cover that, right? So these are some of the key takeaways on the edge as well as on the platform. And of course, the cloud platform, it's a open source platform on the Cloud Foundry. We are I mentioned about this, our CEO's commitment of $2 billion investment and so on and so forth. We are kind of very rapidly expanding that. And it wouldn't, apart from making it available on SAP's data center, we are also having the plans to put it on AWS and so on that would expand your needs of country specific. For example, if you're operating in France or any other country, you don't have to worry about where the data center is. You can leverage SAP data center or the AWS data center as well. So just to give you a quick overview on this cloud, what I was talking about. So there is an aspect of Internet of Things within this cloud platform that we are investing heavily around everything that I mentioned, with device management, the aspect of smart data streaming, event service streaming, the edge capabilities. But the product itself provides very rich capabilities for integration to your backend. We have the whole API layer for SAP ERP, SAP warehouse management, transportation management, so that you can very easily integrate to your backend process to drive the newer outcomes. That's a key element to that. The whole user experience that you want to deliver, it's very ubiquitous. It's based on our HTML5 technology. What some of you who are SAP customer would know it by the name Fiori as well. And we also have a partnership with Apple, wherein we are providing the Apple's SDK to our platform so that you can develop the native Apple screens as well, right? So the mobility is part of the same user experience as well. Security is built into that, and the analytics aspect also. So what this does is that it provides you with the end-to-end ability to kind of develop the mobile, or sorry, develop the applications irrespective of which device you want to run it, whether it's PC, browser, you know, your Samsung device or Apple device, you should be able to kind of run the same UI on top of it. And the security aspect in terms of data tenancy, in terms of user management, in terms of authorization, role-based access, and so on, is covered by inherently by a security that is available here. Just a last slide around the smart data streaming, which is one of the key elements in the IoT for the streaming analytics. Of course, we are one of the leaders, given that this technology comes from the financial world that we are leveraging here. So in summary, just a key takeaways. So it's not just the platform. It's not just, you know, things to analytics. We are talking about things to outcome. That's why we are delivering some of the industry solutions as an accelerator on which you can build, right? Our partners are also building this very, very rapidly and putting it on our store, leveraging our platform. The edge, like I mentioned, is one of the most advanced edge capabilities that we are providing with our 60 different protocols with intelligence built into it, online, offline sync, irrespective of what your connectivity situation is. For any low latency, high volume scenario, we have the smart data streaming with the big data tiering capability as well that we can provide, right? So, and of course, the partnerships in terms of, you know, partnership with the device providers, the gateway providers like Intel, Dell, all the key names that we have, HP and so on, we are partnering with them, as well as a lot of sensor manufacturers that we are ever increasing that partnerships as well. With this, I'll open it up for any questions that you may have. We have about 5 minutes left.
How do you see that? How do we convince our customers? You have to do this because sometimes they don't have any clue or any data to support the decision. So it's
sorry.
Yeah, Ignacio Romero from
Now, when we engage with the customer, I mean, obviously, we work with them for the business case development. So we have a whole repository of benchmarks and so on. So we help our customers put their business case out in front of the management. So that's step one. Step two is that, okay, do they believe us in that business case? That's where we work with them, with our SI partners and so on, to put some kind of proof of concept for that, like we did with the HPA, with the Triangle, and a lot of other customers as well. So doing that first pilot is critical. And of course, with a cloud-based solution and so on, so I mean, of course, customer needs to put some commitment from the business side as well, because we want to prove out that business case for them. And if it is attractive enough, they would do that, right? So that's a step two of kind of running the pilot with the customers to prove out this business case. And I would say 99.99% of the time we have seen this level of digital transformation with IoT delivers the value consistently. And we are working with over 1,000 customers right now, in different, so to say, capacity, right from, developing business case to doing the pilot and also post-pilot and so on across different industries. When you're consistently seeing there is a business value, tremendous business value that they can achieve, right? And once they are fully live, it's a matter of months for the ROI. It's that amazing.
Any other questions?
All right, so if you have any other questions, if you want to meet me, I'll be at the SAP's booth area as well. I'm here for the rest of the day. Feel free to drop in at any point. My name is Rakesh Gandhi, so you can ask anybody at the booth and they'll call you. Thanks for joining.